Greetings. My name is Kevin Matthews, and I am the tax professor. Welcome back to class. Remember, class was never really out of session because the learning never stops. We're going to talk about today the child tax credit. The child tax credit is, of course, a very important credit if you have young kids. It helps you to offset some of those costs that kids can be. Trust me, I have a 14-year-old. I know very, very well that kids can be very expensive. We love them to death, but, you know, of course, anything that can allow us to get some savings, of course, always helps. And so under the pre-2018 tax rules, what would end up happening was there was a $1,000 tax credit that was available, but then what they would do is that if you made something over $110,000, they'd start doing this thing called a phase out. And so what ended up happening is that if you were a family that lived here in the Washington, D.C. metro area, New York, Boston, Seattle, San Francisco, any of those really high cost areas, what would happen is more likely than not, you would be phased out of these child tax credits, even though you're not making money that's considered excessive, so to speak. The idea with most of these phase outs is that they want to phase out the tax credit so that, you know, people who are making sufficient money, probably more well-off individuals are not getting advantages of these tax credits. And the reason why society does that is actually twofold. Number one, taxation as a philosophy really is supposed to be based off the idea of affordability. And so they're not going to make you pay if you can't afford it. And that's also part of the reason why Congress likes to do these kinds of tax credits, is because they figure if you're, you know, lower income, you're raising kids, you probably need extra money in order to be able to raise them and have the available resources to raise them as best possible. And, you know, so Congress obviously likes to do it. The second reason why there's phase outs. Oftentimes, and it's actually more of the practical reason, Congress wants to be able to do these kind of tax cuts and actually make them more quote unquote affordable. And I say affordable because what happens is when, you know, and I don't want to get into the whole thing of it, that would be a tax policy class, but when they build these tax laws, one of the things they say is how much revenue is the government going to lose by enforcing this type of a tax credit? And so when they take a look at it, they're kind of like, okay, it's going to cost, again, cost air quotes, this much money. And as a result of which, they want to shrink that down to a smaller amount. They can use these phase outs as a way of doing that. And so that's more of a practical reason why a lot of Congresses in the past have actually used them. Now, under the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act in 2018, they're actually increasing the tax credit from $1,000 to $2,000. The second thing that they're going to do is they're going to increase these phase-outs. The phase-outs used to start off at $110,000. They're now going to jump to $400,000 if you're married filing joint. And so that's a huge, significant advantage for a lot of people who live in the high-cost areas who are raising kids. Just because you make that kind of money and you live in a high-cost area doesn't mean the kids are any less expensive. In fact, sometimes they can be even more expensive. So this is actually going to be something that we're going to see a lot of benefit from. And if you're living in one of these areas, for example, like I said, Washington, D.C., New York, Boston, Seattle, San Francisco, you're probably used to never even seeing the child tax credit. And sometimes you'll look at it and go, why do I never get a child tax credit? And your tax advisor says you make too much money. That's not going to be the case going forward. And so you're going to see a significant benefit as a result of that. Now, in 2018 to 2025, there's also going to be a $500 non-refundable partial credit, which is allowed for qualifying dependents other than qualifying children. Now, qualifying children is defined as, you know, your child, but also has to be under the age of 17. If you have a person who's a qualifying dependent, which would be similar to the rules under the old exemption rules, but your children is not under the age of 17, you may still qualify for a $500 non-refundable tax credit. And that's actually something that when I was initially told about these tax credits, I didn't even know about myself. And when I learned about this, I was actually very happy in talking to many of my clients about them going forward. Again, when we talk about the phase outs have gone up from $110,000 to $400,000 married filing joint, and then of course there's different limits if you have other if you have other requirements. So something else that's going to actually be important this year is actually going to be the requirement for a Social Security number. And this is really going to affect a lot of our clients who are international taxpayers and maybe are not, those citizens of the United States. What ends up happening is that in order to be able to get the $2,000 tax credit, you are going to have a Social Security number for your child. They're going to require that. Now, if you do not qualify for the Social Security number, you're going to have to get what's called an I-10 or an A-10. I-10 is basically an identification tax number. An A-10 is actually an adoption tax identification number. I don't see these too often anymore. I-10s were very, very common in our office because, like I said, we have a lot of international clients. But if you have either the I-10 or the A-10, you're still going to be able to claim the $500 credit, but you may not be able to get, or you will not be able to get the $2,000 tax credit, which is unfortunate. Something else that we want to talk about in this before wrapping up today, I've had a lot of clients who've come to me and asked me, "Hey, Kevin, we're no longer doing exemptions anymore under the tax law. So should I even be filling out a W-4? And the question, and the answer to that question really is yes. Well, you're going to have to anyways. Employers are going to still be required to do W-4s. But you still want to consider how much you still want to withhold. And that's still going to be very important. But you're going to need to base it off of how many kids that you have who qualify for this tax credit. And so if you take a look at it and you want to figure that out, here at Beta Solutions, we actually do a lot of these projections in order to be able to figure out what your W-4 needs to be set at. Oftentimes what happens is people will read the page and they'll just read the instructions and they'll file as is. And that can actually be a little dangerous. I know that, following IRS instructions normally is considered a good thing, but we've actually noticed in the past when people actually do that, sometimes it works out for them and sometimes it works very against them because it just doesn't set things up correctly. So if you have any questions about that, feel free to leave that in the comment box below, and I'll be happy to walk you through how some of that stuff takes place. So that's all I got to say about the child tax credit for today. My name is Kevin Matthews. I am the tax professor. Remember, classes are still going to be in session because the learning never stops. If you have any questions that you want to leave for me, you can leave them in the comment box below, or you can go to my website, which is www.betasolutionscpa.com. That's www.betasolutionscpa.com. And I'll be happy to respond to any questions that you have. It's no pressure. I actually enjoy the learning and I enjoy the challenge. I do have sometimes where people reach out to me about random things and I'm kind of like, wow, I don't even know that myself. I want to find out the answer. And of course, we're gonna get you to that correct answer as best as we can. Again, thank you very much for watching the video.